الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن سار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، وإن شاء الله في صورة عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته، آمين. في صورة البقرة، واليوم كما ذكرناه بإذن الله تعالى سنشرع في تفسير آية الكرسي. As we said last week إن شاء الله, today by the will and the grace of Allah سبحانه وتعالى we'll start إن شاء الله بتفسير آية الكرسي. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it inshallah easy, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the sincerity in seeking the knowledge that get us close to him. طيب, as you remember, last week we finished ayah number 254, and today inshallah we'll go to ayah number 254. I mean, we finished 54 and 53, and today we'll start with the ayah 254, inshallah. يقول المولى سبحانه وتعالى, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي يوم لا بيع فيه ولا خلة ولا شفاعة والكافرون هم الظالمون. The meaning of this ayah, or the translation of the meaning, O believers, or O who believe, donate from what we have provided for you. That means give away from what we provided you of rizq for you before the arrival of a day when there will be no bargaining, no friendship, no intercession, and those who disbelieve are truly the wrongdoers. طيب, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, as you may notice, started this ayah by addressing the believers, those who believe. And as we said before many times, whenever Allah azza wa jal address you as a believer, then you should listen carefully for the command that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the word that he will say to you. Because either he will command you to do something, or maybe he prohibits you from doing something, or he may tell you about something that a reminder that will benefit you in your life. This is was, as we said, it has been repeatedly emphasized that starting a discourse with a call indicates the importance of what is being addressed. So starting by, O believe, as you said, listen to this believer, be careful. Pay an attention for what, we, you know, the word that will come. So this is why, my dear brothers, always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and many times say, O you who believe, Ya ayyuha alladhina aman, Ya ayyuha alladhina aman. So we should be very careful when this any ayah start with this, because it's called for us to listen carefully for this. And alerting, you know, is only, as you know, necessary in a matter of significance. So always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call us, because this is very important matter to take care of. Right. So directing the call of believers signify what? Signify that adhering to the mentioned requirements of faith. Adhering to the mentioned requirement of faith. That means you are listening to this motivated by your belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, motivated by your faith. Therefore, this call is very important for you. doesn't matter whether they are commands or prohibition. As we said, prohibition. So, because whatever Allah Azza wa Jalla commands us to do, we should do it. Whatever He prohibits, then we will stay away. So, this is very important and very essential. So, not obeying these requirements, in fact, in the side of the person who listen or receiving this call, indicate deficiency. Deficiency, that means there is some problems or weakness of his faith or belief. As if to say, as we said, oh, you have believed due to your faith. So this is the meaning when Allah Azza wa Jal starts with this sentence or this word. O you who believe, due to you. Belief and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you stated that you are a believer by saying the shahada and entering this deen, then you should listen to his command and do it and listen to whatever he is telling you that is prohibited, then you should avoid. So Allah's statement here, give or donate or spend from what we have provided. Now look at this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you command and at the same time remind you about His grace and about His favor. Spend. Spend of what? What we have provided you. Remember that whatever you spend, in fact, it is already originally belong to Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the one who gave it to you in the first hand. So this refers to spending as form of giving. You spend, you donate, that's mean give away. And this, the ulama said, this command spending here refers to specifically in obedience to Allah. That's mean your motive when you spend is sincerely. Your intention is sincerely to please Allah Azza wa Jal. And therefore, some ulama, they refer this, that this is referred to the obligatory spending. Like whatever is commanded by the Muslim to spend. Like, for example, you spend, you know, at your wife, at your family, at your children, at your parents. These are the type of spending which is must or obligatory in the Muslim. Also, there are another obligatory spending which is related to what? To the zakah. If there is, it's applicable in your case that you spend and you give of the zakah for whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided you. And this is what we call it, the right of the needy and the right of the poor and other, you know, way of spending for the zakah, the eight categories that we already spoke about it many times, which is mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, we have provided you, which means remember that when you spend, in fact, just remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who gave you this. It's not because of your power or your intelligence. The provider is Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our Razzaq. So when He said provided you or gave you, that's mean we have granted to you. So the apparent meaning of this ayah, as you see it, is that spending is unrestricted in any form of goodness. This ayah, you see, is spent. So it was not restricted to any, you know, or certain bad. It is general ayah in the meaning of spending. However, this generality that we see it in this ayah, in fact, is restricted by other ayat, other verses. Like what? For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, and spend in the way of Allah. Now just restrict this. Spend in the way of Allah. في سبيل الله. في سبيل الله. That means to support his religion, to support his deen. You know, this is في سبيل الله. It was restricted here. It's not just any spending. Or, for example, in ayah, other ayat, which mention about spending on parents or the will qurba. So there are other ayat sometimes which specify the general meaning of this ayah. Same like in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is why, my dear brothers and sisters, when we read the Quran or when we read the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should be careful not just to go ahead and try to take from this ayah or this hadith a rule, because this ayah or this hadith maybe explain or more details were given in other ayat or other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the next point, when we said Allah azza wa jalla saying, "Min qabli an ya'ti yawm," before there comes a day. This is here is like a warning. And this day referred to the day of judgment. So it is referred to the day of judgment. When there will be, look at the ayat, no trade, no friendship, nor intercession. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us that now you have a time. This is the span of time that was given to you for to be trialed in this life, in this dunya. Now you have ability to choose, you have the ability to decide, the ability to give and to do and to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when the person die, this is the day for him, for the individual, that is the day of judgment for him. This is the qiyamah. This is the end of his life in this world. So all your freedom to spend or to do anything of good is stop. Stop with what? With death. Therefore, the Muslim should be very careful to work in this life, because, as mentioned, you see, when the person die, you know, as said by some ulama, if the resurrection day or the judgment day for every individual's is the day that he died. We're not talking about the general, when you talk the last day or the day of judgment when people are gathered. Why? Because the person, when he die, his deeds will be sealed. He cannot add anything except what was mentioned, for example, in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that there are three matters or three sources of goodness that we do in this world that may benefit us after our death, which is beneficial knowledge that the person taught during his life, or spread, or he wrote books, or any knowledge that he taught. This is will be as some of the good deeds, because it will continue. People will benefit from it after his death. Or a charity that will stay like waqf, a masjid that you build, water, for example, spring of water, or water sources, or well that you dig during your life, and after you know the person die, people will benefit from this and drink from this water. Or a righteous son. And when you say righteous son, that doesn't mean it is a male. Dua for you after you leave this world. So these are things. But other than these three, the person, his time to benefit, to get goodness is over. So these are three things. Trade. What do you mean by trade? La bay'. Bay', that means selling or buying. And this is what we call it trade. Why the trade is mentioned here? Because people benefit from exchanging goods. So the person at that day, he will not have this mean to get hasanat. There will be no way, no trade, no commercial, you know, transaction at that day. It's over. Your business, you should conduct it, you should do it in this life. And then he mentioned friendship. Why? Friendship is very important because which is the highest form of love. You see, in the English it said friendship, which is like sadaqah in Arabic. But the word said khilla. And khilla, my dear brothers and sisters, is more deep than just friendship. That's what they call it, you see, which is some type of love that get into the cell or every cell in the body of the person, especially at his heart. That's mean this love overwhelming this person. This is what you call it khilla. This is why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I cannot take anyone as Khalil except, you know, and for Abu Bakr is my friend. Because the khilla, this type of love that control the person, you know, get into every cell in his body and his soul, in his heart, in his mind, this is the kind of love that will make this person do anything to help you or provide some assistance. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned this specifically, that even the one who is very close to you in love and care, at that day will not benefit you. And this is what we call it, is what the khilla or primated of love or care. So this refers to another aspect that may benefit the person. So either trade or friendship. And this is why, my dear brothers and sisters, the kuffar, the disbeliever at the day of judgment, they will be regret that they don't have even a good believer friends, you know, that can maybe help them. And this is why, because for those friends, for example, as we said, there will be some benefit, but with certain conditions. And this is what we call it shafa'a. So, وَمَا لَنَا مِنْ وَلَا صَدِيقٍ حَمِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, الْأَخِلَّاءُ بَعْضُهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوْ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. Those friends, that mean deep friendship, khilla, at the day of judgment, they will be enemies for each other. They don't care about each other, except the righteous. The righteous, the believers, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor the believer by giving him permission to intercept to for his friend or his brother in Islam. So here, as we said, the Khalil is the one whom his love primated in the heart. And this is the highest form of love, meaning that this love primates the soul, blend with it, becoming as essential as life. This is why it's called Khalil or Khilla. So for this reason, as I mentioned, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if I were to take Khalil, very deep, close friend for me, of my nation, then I would have taken Abu Bakr. But he is my brother in Islam. Why? Because the Khilla is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself took our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as Khalil, same like Ibrahim. So Ibrahim is Khalilullah, and also Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam Khalilullah. طيب. So that's all forms of mutual exchange at that day are absent, and include intercession are absent. So therefore, there is no way to benefit from friends or trade or somebody to intercept for you. So another thing that is negated, as you notice, you know, after I mentioned these two, which is very important also, the intercession. Intercession, which means when someone, you know, will try to help someone to get some benefit or to help him to prevent some harm. So this is the meaning of intercession. We call it shafa'ah. And this, which is pure kindness from the intercessor to the one being interceded for, even without friendship, maybe sometime without friendship, somebody that you know. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah will tell us that nothing at all will help you at that day. Therefore, take advantage of your span of your life in this world. So Allah stated, nor intercession. Thus, he negates all means by which one might benefit on that day. So the apparent meaning, my dear brothers and sisters, apparent meaning, that's mean the general meaning that we can understand it, that the ayah also negate intercession entirely. But we know, and we should reconcile this, we need to reconcile this ayah also with other texts that affirm intercession on that day. That mean there is exception for this. There is exception for this general statement or general ayah would say there is no intercession. There is exception. What is the exception? You see, the other texts, yeah, like ayat or a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ indicate that intercession does exist, but it has three conditions. So there are intercession at the day of judgment, but under certain conditions. What are they? The first one is Allah's pleasure, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pleasure with the intercession. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with the one, that's mean this one, who will intercess for you. In fact, he has, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor him. Allah is pleased with him, like prophets, like angels, they are very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like a righteous believer, Allah pleased with his good deed. So he will give them this honor that he will permit him to be intercessor for the one that he likes. This is the first condition. And this, as you as mentioned earlier with the ayah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and the disbelievers are, you know, regarding the intercession, we mentioned that the disbelievers, they will not have any chance to intercede for each other. Right. And the second condition is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permission. That's Allah permit this. That من ذا الذي يشفع إلا بإذنه. Nobody can intercept unless he will ask Allah permission, so he will do this. And you remember in the hadith, the great messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم at the day of judgment, you know, when people will come to him, ask him that he intercept for them to start the judgment, what the Prophet ﷺ will do? He will not say, okay, and we'll do it. No, he will go and then he will prostrate under the throne of Allah and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the most beautiful words of praising that Allah Azza wa Jal will teach him, and then he will be given the permission. Irfa' ma'asak. فاسأل تعطى تشفع واشفع تشفع, as mentioned in the hadith. Raise your head, ask, it will be given. Intercept and it will be accepted. This is the permission. So this is the second condition. The third condition, Allah Azza wa Jal is pleased with the one whom will receive this intercession. It will not be for anyone. طيب. And then Allah سبحانه وتعالى said, and the disbelievers are the wrongdoers. So, as we mentioned, at that day, Allah سبحانه وتعالى encouraged us to spend before it's come, you know, that all ways, all means that the benefit person is blocked except with the will of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And then Allah عز وجل closed the eye with this. والكافرون هم الظالمون. الكافر, the word كافر in Arabic, it has two meaning in the linguistic, because the word كفر or كفر, the verb كفر in Arabic means to cover, to hide. This is why the disbeliever, you know, called كافر, because he in fact ignored the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the right of Allah azza wa jalla to be worshipped. But also there is other, you know, it could be used in other place. For example, the farmers, the farmer called kafir or kuffar because they cover the seed under the soil. So here we're not talking about the religious meaning of kafir. But here also, this is why some ulama, they said, when Allah Azza wa Jal said in this ayah, and the disbelievers are the wrongdoers, it could be of two meaning. The first meaning that this referred to the disbelievers in general. And for sure, the disbelievers are wrongdoers. Why? And they are oppressor and they are unjust in what they, whatever they are doing. And the most and very clear injustice that, you know, the person worship somebody other than the one who created him. The other meaning is, you know, which is related to spending here, that those who hide or they ignore or they don't evaluate the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal, the one who gave them this wealth, gave them this blessing. Therefore, it's just like a person who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling him, spend from what I gave you. And this person, he doesn't look at what Allah Azza wa Jal gave him. So he is maybe deny it, you know, in a form that he will not spend of it and think that he is, it is his and he's the one who wrote this. So this is why Allah Azza wa Jal said, mention this ayah as it is mentioned in some hadith. So the emphasis in wrong is placed on them due to the enumerate their wrongdoing. Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala said in another ayah, indeed associating partners with Allah is a great wrong. And this is the advice of Luqman when he was advising his son. This is in Surah Luqman. And the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when he talk about this, and when they ask him, the sahaba informed us, you know, that the greatest wrong is to make rival for Allah. Allah, while he is created you. When they ask the Prophet, what is the major sin? He said, the greatest wrong is to make a rival for Allah while he created you. So everyone also who deny the blessing of Allah, in fact, he is, you know, doing a wrong door according to this ayah. طيب. Let's go now to the lesson we learned from this great ayah. The virtue of spending from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted us or give us. When he said, O you who believe, which begin with the call of the belief as we said. And then spending is a requirement of faith. As we said, why it is a requirement? Because you acknowledge the blessing of Allah on one side, and beside also that you use the wealth of Allah and spend it in the way that He directed you. Either it is obligatory or something, you know, optional. Therefore, stingness is deficiency in faith. Thus, believer cannot be never ever be stingy. طيب. The believer is generous. This is the way it should be. With his knowledge generous with his status, generous with his wealth, and generous with his body, always. Generous in his knowledge, he passed the knowledge that he got and teach it to others and share it with them. Generous in his status, that means if he's able to help someone to get his right and he have his status, if people respect him and he can, you know, talk to someone to help someone who is in need, or generous in his wealth, if he has the money, then he will give away not only the obligatory zakah, but also other donation would help others, or generous with his body, helping somebody, carrying his stuff, or showing the way, or any way, you know, that he can be generous. Fourth, highlighting Allah's grace upon us and provision. The provision from Allah, therefore we should realize this and remember it. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla always remind us about his grace and his bounty by saying, from what we have provided you. So then commanding us to spend in his cause and promising also reward for it. Spend from what we have provided you. So Allah has given it to you. So it is his wealth. And then he tell you to spend. And then he will reward you for what you spent. While in fact it is his money from the first hand. طيب. Indicating that a person does not obtain sustenance merely by their earning. Earning is a cause. This is the way that my dear brother and sister, we should look at it. Earning, the way that we do, studying, getting good degrees, getting skill, and then getting job, all these are only means. Who's the one who provides? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, you'll find some, you know, to see that some people, they don't have that skill, they don't have that knowledge, subhanallah, and they inherit million, maybe of riyals. Why? Because inherited from some of his relatives. And some people who are very skilled and have knowledge, you know, and have good experience, and they strive hard, and they don't get that much money. Why? Because all these are means. And the real provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why, my dear brothers, always, always we ask Allah for rizq. And you see, when we prostrate, and then we sit between the prostrate, what do we say? رَبَّ غْفِلِّي وَرْحَمْنِي وَرْزُقْنِي. Provide me. So always, my dear brothers, don't depend, be careful. Put this in your mind always. Don't depend in your power, in your intelligence, you know, on your skill. Always remember that Allah is the one who is giving. Therefore, you do this, you try your best, but ask Allah to give you and bless you with bless whatever He provides you. One should not be impressed by oneself and think that what they have earned is solely from their own effort. So don't just, you know, think that you are the smart one, but remember that it is the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal who grant you this wealth. Indicating that a servant has no favor over Allah for what they spend in his cause, because what they spend is from Allah's provision for them. So don't, when you give, when you spend, when you give poor people, when you give zakah, don't think that you are doing favor to Allah. You are doing favor for yourself. Because what you are giving, it originally was given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. When a person dies, it is very important to understand and realize, and it is as if the day of resurrection has occurred for them. Why? Because the seals, I mean his work, his action, his saying, any good deeds is already sealed. Nothing will be added except what we mentioned now. On that day, which is the day of judgment, there is no possibility of achieving one desire by any means that may lead to fulfillment in this world, such as trade, friendship, intercession. One can only attain their desire through obedience to Allah Azza wa Jalla. الباقيات الصالحات. The good deeds that will last forever and will benefit you at the day of judgment. The disbeliever will not benefit from intercession. This is why there's no benefit. They will never. Why? As we said, because one of the conditions of intercession that Allah Azza wa Jal is pleased with the one who intercedes, the one who will be intercessor for him, and the Allah Azza wa Jal gave permission to this. And for sure, the disbeliever will not get this because they already, you know, disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. Disbelief is the greatest injustice. A person does not benefit from their wealth after their death, as Allah Azza wa Jal said, and spend from what we have provided you before that comes, day comes. That means at that day will not benefit. What you live in this life will be for your hires. This is why the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, the meaning, يقول ابن آدم مالي مالي. The son of Adam say, my money, my money. And وليس لك من مالك إلا ما أكلت فأفنيت. And all what you own of your wealth is what you already ate and it's already finished. أو لبست فأبليت. Or something that you wear and then it will be, you know, finished. أو تصدقت فأبقيت. Or that something that you give it away as charity and this is the one that will remain for you. This is what will be beneficial for you in the day of judgment or in the hereafter. طيب, now we'll start with Ayat al-Kursi. And Ayat al-Kursi, as you know, it is يعني special ayah in the Quran. In fact, it is the greatest ayah of the Quran. And we'll go, inshallah, to talk at the, some introduction about the benefit, I mean, the special thing about this great ayah or the virtue of Ayat al-Kursi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسي السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم. The meaning of this ayah. Allah, there is no God or deity worth to be worshipped except Him. The everlasting, all sustaining, neither drowsiness nor sleep overtake Him. To Him belongs whatever is in the heaven and whatever is on the earth. Who could possibly intercede with him without his permission? He fully knows what is ahead of them. That means their future, what will happen for you, and what is behind them. But no one can grasp any of his knowledge except what he wills. Unless Allah Azza wa Jal taught us about it, like about his names, his attributes, the unseen, all these things, we'll never know it except through the revelation when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran and revealed to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But no one grasps any of his knowledge except what he wills to reveal. His seat encompasses the kursi, the heavens and the earth, and the preservation of both, that's mean the heaven and the earth, does not tire him, for he is the most high, the greatest. Look at many great, subhanallah, meanings in this one ayah. This is why this ayah, Ayat al-Kursi, consider as the greatest ayah of the Quran, in the Quran. Look now at some of the verses of Ayat al-Kursi. طيب. The first one, for example here, It is the greatest ayah in the book of Allah. آية الكرسي, آية number 255 من سورة البقرة, is the greatest ayah in the entire Quran. We know that there is greater surah. As سورة الإخلاص, قل هو الله أحد, is the greatest surah, chapter. But as ayah, one verse, the greatest ayah is آية الكرسي. This base, my dear brothers and sister, in the hadith. And this hadith was reported by Imam Muslim. Ubay ibn Ka'b, radiallahu anhu, reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, which ayah in the book of Allah is the greatest? Ubay replied, Allah and his messenger know best. He was very polite. Look at the, you know, the politeness of the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim. You know. So they deny their knowledge without the knowledge that was given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and provided through the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he didn't. And then he repeated. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeated this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam insisted in him, he repeated this after repeated several times. He said, Ubay said, آيات الكرسي. Now he then, عليه الصلاة والسلام, the Prophet والسلام said to him, he put his hand on his chest, on chest Ubay, and say, may knowledge bring you joy, Abu al-Munzir. Abu al-Munzir, this is the nickname of Ubay. Abu al-Munzir, his nickname. He said, Allah. The Prophet والسلام was talking to him nicely, calling him by his nickname and said, may knowledge bring you joy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with this great knowledge that you have. As it a matter of what? A form of what? Approving his answer. Approving his answer. Because that's mean you are right. And you are, mashallah, have a good knowledge. Because you know what is the greatest ayah in the Quran. So this is to show you one of the virtues of Ayatul Kursi, that it is the greatest ayah. Second, this ayah, my dear brothers and sisters, is a protection from jinn and deprive the devils. And this mentioned in the hadith Abu Hurairah, radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in Surah Al-Baqarah, there is ayah, there is verse, that is the chief of all verses in the Quran. No devil can remain in house where it is recited, Ayatul Kursi. And this narrated through another route from Zayda, from Al-Hakim or Ibn Jabir, and there's other reports which confirm this. This is why, my dear brothers, we always, it is good, you know, that when you go to your bed, we were commanded, we were advised, when you go to bed, to recite Ayatul Kursi. When you at the home, try to recite Surah Al-Baqarah, because this protection. And in this Surah Al-Baqarah, this is Ayatul Kursi. The third, Ayatul Kursi contain the greatest name of Allah. Now, what is the significance of knowing the greatest name of Allah? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in hadith that there is a name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If anyone asks him by that name, then his prayer will be answered. So the ulama have different views. What is this name? And was not mentioned in any hadith, you know, exactly which name. There are some narrations. Some that it is it said it is Allah. Some they said it is Al-Hay. Some it said al different. But here the hadith of Rasulullah tell us that the name, the greatest name of Allah is included in Ayatul Kursi. Therefore, when you recite Ayatul Kursi, when you say Ayatul Kursi, you ask Allah Azza wa Jal with the greatest name that you have. This is why some of the dua istighfar said, Astaghfirullah al-Azim alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum wa atubu ilayhi. استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه. Because the gracious name is mentioned in this. How we know this? Because this what was mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So regarding its inclusion of the greatest name of Allah, الإمام أحمد بن حنبل رحمه الله reported from أسماء بنت يزيد ابن السكان who said I heard the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say regarding these two verses there is two ayat be careful Allah there is no deity except him the ever living the sustainer of existence this mean mentioned to what ayat al-kursi and Allah la ilaha illa huwa الحي القيوم this is mentioned the meaning ever living الحي the sustainer القيوم of existence and then is the name of Allah the greatest now where is this ayah the second ayah the second ayah is the beginning of Surah Al-Imran Surah Al-Imran see the third surah The beginning of the first ayah, Alif, Lam, Mim, this is the first ayah. And then, Allah, there is no, Allah, la ilaha illa huwa, al-hayy al-qayyum. So, this report that the gracious name of Allah are mentioned in these two verses. And if you look and compare these two verses, you will find they are similar as we mentioned. طيب. Also, reciting it after every prayer may get the person to Jannah. May it will be a mean or cause or reason by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enter Jannah, enter paradise. And this was mentioned in this hadith in the authority of Abu Umama, who said, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever recite Ayatul Kursi after every obligatory prayer, nothing will prevent him from entering paradise except this. This means just, you know, the thing that between you and Jannah, وابن سني عند فضائل الأعمال and this عمل الليل عمل اليوم والليلة this is some of the reports which mentioned or reported this hadith طيب it is cause for protection of Allah for the one who recited after obligatory salah also so now you get two benefits when you recite Ayatul Kursi Every time you pray, after you finish your prayer, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, these are five. After you say that card, you recite Ayat al-Kursi. And the authority of Al-Hasan ibn Ali, radiallahu anhuma, who said, the Messenger of Allah وسلم, said, whoever recite Ayat al-Kursi after the obligatory prayer will be in the protection of Allah until the next prayer. And this consider hadith is weak by Sheikh Al-Albani. But if you look at the general meaning, it is true. It is correct. Because there is other hadith which said that between from one salah to other salah, there is protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, one of the virtues of this ayah, it brings Allah protection and keep devils away until the morning. As we mentioned, when you go to bed, you recite this ayah. I mean this ayat al-Kursi, as mentioned in the hadith of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this, there is a long hadith. And you... from When you go to your bed, recite Ayatul Kursi, and there will be remain you and remain upon you a guardian from Allah, and no devil will approach you until the morning. So when the Prophet, I mean, when Abu Huraira reported this and informed the Prophet about this, what was the answer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? What was his response? He said, he told you the truth, though he is a liar. And then he told him, that was a devil. Yes, the Prophet ﷺ approved this. That means it is true. If you recite Ayatul Kursi when you sleep, there will be protection for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we stop the Surah 27 now. So we'll stop here. For to leave, I think, yeah. So inshallah, next week we'll start the explaining of the meaning of ayat al-kursi. Barakallahu fikum wa jazakumullahu khair. And leave sometimes if you have any questions regarding what we discussed today. Naam. Any question? Right,
Assalamu
anything in the
alaikum.
chat box? Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Go ahead, sister.
I would just like to know that how are we to take when a weak hadith is, why is it narrated? Like, what is the benefit for us? Because we are looking for
good.
Strong hadiths always. Sahih and Hassan Hadith, why is a weak Hadith given? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jazakallah. This is very, very good question, in fact, because some people are confused about this. Now, as you know, a Hadith are classified into Sahih, which is the highest, and then Al Hassan, that means it is also correct with different narrations support each other. And the weak. Now, the weak hadith, the ulama said, we don't take it or depend on it when we are talking about rules and obligation and regulation. Okay? So in terms of rules, either obligation or it is something which is prohibited or any rules, we must depend only in authentic hadith, which is sahih. Regarding the da'if hadith, which is weak hadith, some ulama, they said, it's no problem, okay, to report it, to support, okay, if it is a matter related to what we call it good deeds, or encouraging for good deeds, what they call it, fada'il al-a'mal, to talk about the virtue of certain, you know, nice or good deeds. It's okay to say it, to report it. Why? Because there's no rule, but it is like encouraging. Especially especially if this weak hadith go along and supported by other authentic reports. Okay? That means it's lead to the same idea. But if this weak hadith contradict with something which is authentic, okay, contradict the opposite, then we'll never take it at all. And we'll leave it. I hope this will answer your question. Nah. Yes, Hanin, go ahead, sister.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Sheikh.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
My question is, since the Ayatul Kursi is the powerful ayah in the Quran, is it permissible to use the Ayatul Kursi as a, you know, a decoration in the house or a print of your clothes or anything that remind of that Ayatul Kursi? Jazakallahu khair, ya Sheikh.
بارك الله فيك. The benefit to benefit from the Quran, okay, we should follow the instructions which we receive in the revelation. So it is not the way or the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to protect the house that, you know, he command the Sahaba or in his family or at his home, or even the Sahaba, they did this. They took out a Christian, they wrote it, or they decorate it, or they put it in wall, as some people are doing. Because the secret is not in this letters that is written. Okay? Here, to benefit from the Quran, then it should be from your heart. To the cover, but they didn't benefit anything except watching and looking. Why? Because they just look at the ayat without saying it. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when you recite the Quran, you will be given, you know, a hasana for every letter. Every letter. 10 deeds. Now, if somebody just closes, he doesn't say it, doesn't move his lips with it, and he just look at it, he will not benefit. Maybe, yes, he benefit, he will may think or understand something or maybe get some knowledge. But as ajr for recitation, why? Because if we want to benefit from something, we should use it, you know, according to the instruction that was given to us. And the Quran, my dear brothers and sisters, was not revealed as some people they do. They take mushaf, you know, the text book of the Quran, and they put it in their cards. You'll see an old mushaf by the sun for many long time because it is there in the back or in the front, and you think that putting the mushaf will benefit him. No, it will not. But recite the ayat of Allah. You see, say the dua of rukub when you get into your car, there is certain supplication, certain ayat, سبحان الذي سخر لنا هذا وما كنا له مقرنين, and so on. So the Quran was not revealed or sent down to be taken as text and written, in, you know, and keeping as a blessing, you know, in the clothes or in the house or in the room or in the car. So the right way to benefit from the Quran, the ayatul Quran, is to deal with it according to the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned for us the recitation and the value of the recitation at night. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that we recite Ayatul Kursi after every salah, as we mentioned in some of the, you know, the point that we mentioned there. Or he said that you recite قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ 3 times in the morning after Salat al-Fajr, 3 times after Salat al-Maghrib, and only 1 time after other Salah. Look, it is prescribed clearly. Like when a doctor tell you, take 1 pill in the morning, 1 afternoon, only 2, don't take 3, don't take 2 pills at the same time. So we should follow the instruction exactly to benefit and to get the blessing of you know that we expected from this narration. نعم. Okay. طيب any question the chat box system.
السلام عليكم شيخ.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
Can I play the Quran or the Ayatul Kursi even if nobody is at home? Can I leave the player on even if nobody is listening?
Yeah, some people they say this. Well, some of the scholars say this is a matter of area of different, because the ayah, I mean the hadith that the Prophet said, "Al-bayt alladhi tuqra'u fihi surat al-Baqarah," or tutla surat al-Baqarah, which means the house where the ayat al-Kursi or surat al-Baqarah is recited. So some ulama they said if, for example, there is a TV or radio and recite ayat, it's okay, it is good. But most of the scholars, they said it should be a person who recite it. So if you recite it, this is for sure, it is, there's no question about it. But to recite or to leave the house there, the Quran, that's good. It's better than music or anything else. Nah.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله دكتور يحيى. No questions at the chat box.
طيب جزاكم الله خير. So إن شاء الله we'll see you tomorrow at Fiqh class. I encourage you to attend tomorrow. It will be at 7. Is it 7 or 7:15, Sister Sarah? I think 7 p.m., right?
7 p.m. دكتور يحيى إن شاء الله.
Yeah, 7 p.m. tomorrow. إن شاء الله we are still discussing about الحقيقة, I think. إن شاء الله we'll continue about النذر, الباو, إن شاء الله we'll talk about it, we'll complete it tomorrow إن شاء الله at 7 p.m. بارك الله فيكم وجزاكم الله خير. See you next week for our next tafsir class. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.